Good morning. Welcome to 10th Presbyterian Church. As we prepare our hearts for worship, hear these words from Luke chapter 1. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days."
Thank you. Well, hello, good morning, and welcome to worship this morning on the 10th. We're on the second Sunday of Advent. Many church traditions recognize the Advent season. The word Advent means coming and refers both to the first coming and second coming of our Lord Jesus. We're going to be using an Advent collect from the Book of Common Prayer that you'll find in your bulletin. We'll be using that shortly. Well, let me read some words from Matthew chapter 2 that tie in with our opening hymn, which is number 225. Some wise men came to Jerusalem looking for the King of the Jews, and when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler that will shepherd my people, Israel.'" Using the words you'll find in your bulletin. O Lord, raise up, we pray, your power and come among us, and with great might succor us. And whereas through our sins and wickedness in running the race that is set before us, your bountiful grace and mercy may speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Father God, we thank you that you have promised that you would draw near to us when we gather at your command. We come together as your redeemed people. We come to call in your name, to praise your most excellent greatness, and to ask that you would come and keep company with us, that we may hear you speak to us from your word. And by your Spirit, we pray in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Thank you. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come into your presence this morning with hearts filled with assurance and confidence, not because we are worthy, but because of your Son, Jesus Christ, of whom we have just sung, is worthy. That he came at this time of Christmas that we remember to take on flesh, and then we look forward to Easter when he was slain for our sins. He is the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of all your creation. And we praise you, Jesus, this morning. We praise you, Holy Spirit, for your indwelling in our lives as you continually apply to us the work of redemption and restoration that Jesus has bought for us by his blood. Because of this work, we lift up these concerns of our congregation, indeed of our world, that your kingdom and will be manifest in each situation. We do lift up to you our rulers, our governors, our various representatives. May they govern in righteousness and seek the peace of our nation. Indeed, Father, as we see the news, as we read of the brokenness of this world, we're reminded again that this world is not our home. Yet, while it is not our home, give us the grace, the mercy, and the boldness to speak of your transforming love. We pray that our rulers and authorities would govern with your love, with your justice, with your mercy. Would you set right that which is wrong, comfort the grieving, and bring glory to your name even through the tragedies of this world. We do pray, Father, as we are weak people. We do not often know what to pray, but we pray that your Son would be lifted up here in America and around the world. We pray for our global partners today, those who are facing intense persecution for the name of Jesus Christ. We pray that you would strengthen them. We do pray even for the needs of our own congregation, for those seeking employment, for those who are underemployed, that you would meet their needs, that they can be generous. We do pray, as you have created us to work, that you would provide work for our hands. We do pray for those who are employed as they are working in their specific fields where you have placed us. Will you help us, whether it's medical or business or in the home, in the neighborhoods, wherever you have put us, that even at this time, as there's many conversations with neighbors and coworkers, that you would give us the wisdom and boldness to know what to say. We do even pray for our needs this morning for the building next door, for 1710, 1712, that you would give us wisdom. Father, if it's your will, that you would also provide generously the money that we need to purchase this. Father, please help us to see how we would use this for your glory and for your kingdom. We do pray, as your word is opened up today, that you would touch our hard hearts. Let us see Jesus high and lifted us up. Remove from us the distractions of this week, this week past, and this coming week. May we see Jesus clearly. In his name we pray. Amen. Again, a welcome today to 10th. We do invite you to use the welcome cards that are in the pew in front of you. There's a place there for prayer requests. The staff prays for these requests every Tuesday, so please avail yourself of that. Also, we have a welcome center as you exit the auditorium, as you exit the sanctuary to your right. There's more information about the ministries at 10th that you can find there today. Also, following this service in the fellowship, in the reception hall immediately after this at 9 o'clock, after this service, there's a time for a coffee and a time to meet others. There are several events taking place today and in the coming weeks, so please take a look at your bulletin for what's coming up at this holiday season at 10th. Today, there are two lunches taking place after the 11 o'clock service. Medical campus outreach is meeting in the fellowship hall, which is upstairs behind us, behind the platform here, as well as the Parish 5 Christmas Carol luncheon in the catacombs. Next, the Bible School Christmas program is this afternoon at 4:30, also in the fellowship hall, where children will perform instrumentals and vocals. Light refreshments will be served, and all are invited. Please be aware that there's a certain football game also at 4:30, so please plan accordingly that you don't get caught in traffic. There will be a congregational forum to discuss the possible purchase of the 1710-1712 spruce on Sunday, December 14th, after the 11 o'clock service, which is our living church today, where Frank Harder, one of our elders, will present some findings about that.
Thank you very much. Most of you will know by now that 10th has negotiated a purchase agreement for the property immediately west of the church. The purchase agreement is contingent on a vote of the congregation on January 11th. This will obviously be a very important decision in the life of this church, and the session is recommending approval. The property consists of two buildings, a double-wide house facing Spruce Street, number 17, 10, and 12, and a carriage house, which is contiguous to the nursery rooms in this building, just over my shoulder here. For 10th, I think we need to think about this as a long-term investment. And fundamentally, it's an expression of conviction that the Lord will continue to bless the ministry here and that future generations will faithfully steward that investment, our expense, their benefit. Presently, we would expect to use a property to facilitate at least three broad categories of our mission. First, practical Sunday morning logistics will just get easier. And if you're a veteran like me, that's not so important, but if you're a new person that we want to incorporate into the life of the church, that's very important. Second, the proximity and features of the buildings will promote community, which is an important part of any Christian church, but particularly ours as a metropolitan or regional church. And then third, the buildings will be used to house a new set of outreach ministries. So I realize that I have not answered your questions or don't have time to do that right now. Some of everybody's reasonable questions will be addressed in the 10th Press article, and I want to thank Terry Taylor for preparing that today. In addition, this room has been set aside, as you heard a minute ago, for after next Sunday for a presentation regarding the acquisition that will be similar to those from the parish meetings and provide as much time for questions as anybody needs. We would expect to walk through the building on January 4th and vote on January 11th. Now for me, this acquisition represents a recommitment by this generation of 10th to continually and faithfully preach the gospel and minister in Philadelphia at the corner of 17th and Spruce. A recently passed generation left us with a verse on a bronze plaque on the Delancey building to serve as an inspiration for times like this. And I leave you with that scripture, a portion of Revelation 3:8 to the Church of Philadelphia. It says, "Behold, I've set before you an open door that no one can shut." Now, over the course of the next month, I would ask you to please be in prayer that the Lord would give us one mind about this acquisition. Thank you.
Thank you.
together. God, we thank you that you are a happy God. You're not a cosmic curmudgeon, grumpy, waiting for us to give you things that you need. You do not need things from us. You give to us. You have given us Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be our Savior and our redemption, and you have brought us to you through your Son. And so, God, I thank you that we can come together to worship you. I thank you that you use us through our time, our talent, and our treasure to advance the work of the church, spread of the gospel throughout the city, throughout the world, and throughout our congregation. And so, God, we pray that this money that we give now would be used mightily for your glory, that Jesus Christ would be praised. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Scripture reading for this morning is Matthew 7, 7 through 12, which is a slight change from what's printed in the bulletin, found on page 812 in the Black Church Bible in front of you. Matthew 7, 7 through 12. Hear the reading of God's word. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it will be opened. Or which one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? So, whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. This is God's word.
Well, let's keep our Bibles open at Matthew chapter 7. We're coming towards the end of our study in the Sermon on the Mount, the most famous sermon ever preached. And in this sermon, the Lord Jesus is outlining the nature of the God that we come to worship in chapter 5, the kingdom of God, in chapter 6, the fatherhood of God, and here in chapter 7, the judgment of God. And as we come to this section that we've read this morning, we're reminded that the Christian life is a bit of a balancing act. It's lived on the knife edge. It requires poise and deft footwork if you're to avoid extremes. Impressed as we are daily by the demands and the priorities that are placed upon us as believers, we just need to put our weight on one side or the other, and it brings imbalance, and it can very easily lead to a fall. For example, as we do this balancing act as a believer, we're avoiding, on the one hand, legalism or falling into license, on the other. We're avoiding falling into either bitter pessimism on one side or unrealistic optimism on the other. We're trying to avoid either being quick to condemn or, on the other side, being slow to critique. On the one side, we try to avoid falling into a, quote, only the best is good enough for God mentality. On the other side, the anything goes mentality. In other words, as we've been reading the Sermon on the Mount, we find the Lord Jesus in typical Hebraic fashion, giving us a series of absolutes. And some of those absolutes, as you read them for the very first time, can very easily appear on the surface to be contradictory. It's because when he's emphasizing something, he emphasizes that thing. To some degree, it's what you do when you're preaching. If you're preaching rather than simply lecturing or reading something, when you're preaching, very often you emphasize what it is you're preaching on that day. People may come and leave thinking, oh, this is what it's all about. And in a sense, you've got to keep coming. You've got to keep coming. I think you've got to listen to me preaching for at least 15 years, and then you begin to get the hang of what it's all about. Because in preaching, what you do is you emphasize as much as you possibly can the thing that you are saying at a given moment. And that's what we find Jesus doing in the Sermon on the Mount. Let's remember that he's preaching. And the reality, of course, is that we learn from Jesus that truth is usually far more nuanced, far more finely balanced than our minds are prepared to concede. Very often, if not mostly, in our Christian lives, it's not either or, it is both and, in proper proportion, that is, and with proper understanding. That's certainly what we find in this seventh chapter. At the beginning of the chapter, Jesus has warned us not to judge harshly. He then went on to tell us not to judge naively. That is, on the one hand, we are to avoid judgmentalism, and on the other hand, we are to avoid being undiscerning. So there's a pretty bit of fancy footwork to be done in our Christian lives. And this will often leave us in a position where we wonder, how on earth am I ever going to juggle all of these different kinds of commands that the Bible gives to me? Because by nature, especially if you're young, and I do remember being young, and when I was young, I didn't like the word balance. I would hear preachers use the word balance, and I assumed, this was the conclusion I came to, that if a preacher used the word balance, he was really getting liberal and soft and old and moderate. And here I am this morning, and I'm using the word balance. And I don't know whether it's maturity or whether I'm just reneging in all the enthusiasm and single-mindedness of my youth, but I leave you to judge that for yourself. I think this is what Jesus is doing when he introduces us in verse 7 to the business of prayer. Here we are in the business of trying to discover how to judge properly, as he's told us to do in verse 1, how to discern properly, as he's told us to do in verse 6. How do we do this? How do we know in a specific situation what is judgmentalism and what is being undiscerning? Those are two great big challenges. And so he urges us in verse 7 to ask, to seek, and to knock. Now again, let me fill you in a bit in the background of this sermon. The sermon begins where it now ends. It begins with the emphasis that a person who is a believer is a beggar before God, that we have nothing to offer, that there is nothing. There is no talent, there is no good work, there is no so-called excellent offering that we can make to God. We have absolutely nothing to offer God at all. We are completely poor. We are poverty-stricken when we come into the presence of God. Later on in the New Testament, we discover the only grounds of our acceptance with God is nothing we do but on the work of Christ, who is our most excellent prophet, priest, and king. We come with nothing. That's what it means to be poor in spirit. That was the very first category in which Jesus describes what his people are when he gives us that description that is a composite picture of the believer there in chapter 5 in what we call the Beatitudes. And it is to people like that, then, that he now returns. He returns to show what it means to be a humble believer faced with all these difficult choices in life. We need help. We need help desperately. If we have nothing, then we need something. If we have nothing to bring to the table, then we need something to enable us to serve God and to act rightly in our lives and in our worship and so on. And so Jesus urges us, ask, seek, knock. In the perfectly balanced symmetry of those imperatives, which are emphatic, and in the present tense, Jesus is urging us, keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. With each one, ask, seek, knock, there is an ascending order of urgency. We are to ask, we are to seek, we are to knock. He's urging us to do what? He's urging us to persevere, to be persistent. When we need help, to go for help, to keep asking for help, to seek it out, to long for it, to look for it, to come to God for it, to knock on the gates of heaven until God hears our cries and hears our call and delivers the very thing we're seeking from him. As we've read through this sermon, there's a whole lot of help that you and I need. After all, God requires of me poverty of spirit, but I am by nature proud. God wants of me that I would mourn over my sin, but in fact, by nature, I deny my sin. God wants me to be pure in heart, but my heart is torn by all the images and sights and desires that are around me and within me. God wants of me not to retaliate individually to those who injure me. God wants of me that I would obey his law at a level far deeper than those who are only concerned to tip their hat at the law of God rather than obey it thoroughly and deeply. And in the current context, I need wisdom. I need wisdom to discern what is the will of God. I need wisdom to recognize where I must not throw what is holy to the dogs or cast pearls before pigs. I need discernment to know that. I need grace not to judge people's motives and purposes. I need grace. I need help. Where am I going to find grace and help? the writer to the Hebrews tells us, we find grace to help us in our time of need at the mercy seat as we come close to God, as we come and apply for it to our Father in heaven. And that's the context in which Jesus then introduces, out of the air, as it were, this business of prayer at this very point. He introduces it in a context, you notice, about judgment, and he's going to go on again in verse 12 to talk about judging when he gives us that golden rule, whatever you wish others would do to you, do also to them. This is the law and the prophets. Now, what do I do then when I'm struggling to be a Christian? What do I do when I'm struggling to avoid hypocrisy? What do I do when I'm struggling with my own personal sin? What do I do when I'm faced with anxieties of life, when I'm faced with the pressures of society to want stuff, to identify myself by how much stuff I have? What do I do when I'm trying to discern between who can be trusted and who can't? What am I to do when I'm tempted to be judgmental of people's motives and intentions? Jesus' answer is twofold. Beseech God and believe God. Beseech God. That's what he's asking us to do, telling us to do, summoning us to do in verse 7. Ask and it shall be given to you. Ask. In other words, what he has said right at the very beginning of the sermon now kicks in this practical word, an exhortation from Jesus. What was the very first mark in the profile of a believer in chapter 5? It was this. Blessed are the poor in spirit. We are beggars. We need grace. And Christ is teaching us that Christians must boldly implore their Heavenly Father for grace. You see, this word ask is a word used in the ancient world for the beggar asking for charity. It's also the word used of someone who is in a court of law pleading his case before a judge, pleading for mercy. So this word to ask means to beg. It means to plead. It means to petition. The petition of an inferior to a superior person in society, to petition for help, for assistance. And so when Jesus begins the application of his sermon to our hearts, he begins right here. He says, this is where the Christian life begins. It begins with my recognition that I have needs, that I don't bring anything to God. I come with my needs to God. I come conscious of my need. I come utterly beggarly before him. I come with nothing to him. I come seeking from him. Jesus says, when he's teaching us what it means to come to public worship, is you don't come with anything to give anything to God. Paul says, the God who made the heavens and the earth needs nothing. He comes to give us, to bless us, above all to give us his word and to encourage our hearts. Jesus once told a parable, you can read it in Luke chapter 18, the parable of the Pharisee and the publican. Pharisee goes in to pray. And I want you to read that. It's in Luke chapter 18. You'll notice the Pharisee does not ask God for anything. The Pharisee comes to tell God things, to tell God things about himself. Dear God, here I am today. I'm in your church. And I'm sure, dear God, that you're really privileged that I am here. Look at the way I'm dressed. I'm dressed so finely. Here I am, and I have all these tithes that I can give to you. And here I am with my fine prayer that I'm going to offer to you. The Pharisee is preoccupied with himself rather than God, and he is concentrating on what he has to offer God. He doesn't ask anything of God. Why? He feels no need of anything. He is the direct polar opposite of what Jesus describes in chapter 5 as the believing person who is in the kingdom of God, who has nothing, who knows he has nothing,
who comes into God's presence understanding, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. You have nothing. On the other hand, the publican, you remember, the tax gatherer, the sinner, he comes into the temple and he pleads with God in prayer. He begs God. He recognizes that he has a fundamental need. He is a sinner. And he comes before God and he pleads his case before God in heaven. And he says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Ask. Seek. This is a word that means to search or scour. I don't know if you know the word scour. It's a Scottish word. It just means to seek and search very thoroughly. I remember on one occasion, a long time ago now, when our two little girls, one of them is here today actually in church, and her little girl is over in 1716, one of those buildings that we own. I remember when they were very little, that we were in a forest somewhere in Northern Ireland, going for a forest walk with friends, and the two girls and their friend were kind of wandering here and there and so forth. And we had gone a long way before we realized that they were no longer in our company. Well, I can tell you, we were terrified. We were frightened. This was Northern Ireland at the time of the Troubles, when there was a lot of fighting and so on. Not that it was there in the forest, but it was on your mind. And we just split up and we went everywhere looking for those girls. We spent hours looking for them. All the hours we spent looking for them, they were in fact perfectly safe. Just like the thing, isn't it? They had been found by the ranger. They'd been taken back to the ranger station, and there they were sitting waiting for us when eventually we found them. And I'll tell you this, while we were looking for them, there was nothing else in our minds than finding those girls. We were absolutely focused on finding Louise Ruth and their little friend. And that's the word that's used here. When you come to God, there comes a time in life when there are issues, there are things that you have in your mind, and you bring them to God, and Jesus is saying, you come looking for those things. You come being specific about those things. You come focused on those things that you feel that God needs to hear from you and about which you need to speak to God. You come intensely focused on that thing. And then thirdly, right, ratcheting it up even higher, we are to knock. That word means to pound, to bang on the door. We are to persevere in boldness. We are to seek the thing of God. We are, to use the language of C.H. Spurgeon, we are to besiege the battlements of the celestial city, to get God to break down the doors till we get into the presence of God. We are to be so serious. It's as if we were soldiers laying siege to a citadel in order to gain access to God. So serious are we. I don't know if you have in Scotland we have an expression, the neighbor from hell. And it speaks for itself, actually. I think it translates into any of the English languages that there are, including yours. And there's a story in the Bible that Jesus tells in Luke chapter 11 about the neighbor from hell. You remember, this neighbor had friends who came to stay, and these friends were penniless. They were staying with them, and he found himself with no groceries. He'd forgotten to do his grocery shopping. He had no bread in the house. And so what does he do? Well, he goes to his neighbor next door, and he knocks his neighbor's door, and there's no response because his neighbor's asleep. So he knocks more loudly, and there's no response. And then he's thumping on the door, and the neighbor shouts down, "Go away! We're all here in bed, sleeping." That woke everybody up, of course. But the guy doesn't give up. You remember? He keeps on going. He keeps on going. And Jesus tells that parable, and he says, the man kept on going until eventually the neighbor gives up, gets up, goes out, gives him the bread that he asked for, and says to him, "Now let me go back to sleep again." That's the story Jesus tells. And in these words, ask, seek, knock, Jesus is indicating this persistence in prayer. Don't give up praying.
praying is a priority. You need to pray. You need to pray more than you know you need to pray. If you only prayed, you'd be happier than you are. If only you would cast your burdens on the Lord, do you know? If only you would do that, you would be a much brighter, happier people. And Sunday mornings would be so much brighter for me because you'd be smiling back. Seriously. Matthew Henry, talking about this asking business that Jesus uses here. Matthew Henry once said this, "Those who would be rich in grace must betake themselves to the poor trade of begging, and they will find it to be a thriving business." In other words, when you take to begging of God, you will thrive. You will be prosperous. He has urged you to come humbly, asking, pleading, begging. He's come to tell you to seek, to petition Him, to get focused on the things, the favor that you want Him to give to you. And when it appears to be no answer, He wants you to keep coming again and again and again, diligently, persevering, knocking. Because Jesus is reassuring us here, and He does so in a variety of ways, that God is more ready to give than we are to receive. More ready to be generous towards us than we are to ask Him. In fact, the word that Jesus uses is that He gives gifts. He gives gifts. He longs to give gifts. He longs to bestow upon His people what they need. Paul once said, or James rather was said, "You have not because you ask not. You have not because you ask not." This is a word to a congregation, isn't it? That when it comes to this business of beseeching God, He's looking at the demeanor of our hearts. Are we humble? He's looking at the desires of our hearts. Are we articulating these to Him in prayer? He's looking at the diligence of our hearts. Are we persistent in prayer? But we're not only to beseech God, we are to believe God. He gives three commandments. You notice three commands: ask, seek, knock. And He attaches to those three commands six promises. Ask, and it will be given to you. God's answer meets the need. We ask, it is given. It is not lent, it is not sold, it is not leased, it is given. We ask, it is given to us. Seek, you will find. That's the second promise. God is found of those who seek Him. That's an Old Testament principle. Those who seek the Lord will surely find Him. We are to knock, and it will be opened to you. The door of mercy is opened by the key of prayer. God is sovereign, so why pray? Because God has ordained that blessings come to His people, especially spiritual blessings, through the instrument of prayer. The Puritans had a saying, when the Lord is preparing to bless His people, He sets them a-praying. The other day we were in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Jesus was born there. And the Star of Bethlehem's all over the place. It's an amazing place. I had my own mission while we were there, not just to see the Christmas decorations, which I loved, but I was there to see something of the history of the, what were you laughing at? I didn't say anything funny. The history of the Moravians, that's why I was there. George Whitfield, the great evangelist, actually opened an orphanage in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, which people don't know, and one of the Moravian houses there. I found where the orphanage had been, not because there's a plaque there, but because I'm just a historical genius. I found it, but the interesting thing about the Moravians, this was the real point, that in the 17th century, a group of Moravians started a prayer meeting. They started praying for the mission of the church to the world. That prayer, focused prayer, lasted 100 years. It wasn't the same people praying, but they prayed about the mission to the world for 100 years. In fact, if you look at church history from a global perspective, those 100 years of prayer were followed by the two great missionary centuries of the church, the 18th and 19th centuries. It was amazing. Their prayer for the world to be reached with the gospel was fulfilled in two ways. In this new continent that was being opened up and to which they eventually moved in order to be safe after the 30 years' war in Germany, this continent became the home of people from where? All over the world. People from all over the world heard the gospel and received the gospel on this continent in answer to their prayers. And from this continent, missionaries have gone out round the world proclaiming the good news, planting churches, spreading the gospel, and proliferating the kingdom of God in answer to their prayers. God was preparing to launch an assault that would cause the 19th century to be known as the century of missions and even as the Christian century. And he'd had his people praying for 100 years before the blessing came out. A godly man, I remember doing a university mission in Aberdeen University, and we used in our prayer cards in preparation for that mission some words in which the writer says this: whenever God plans to do a work, first of all, he makes his plan. Then he gets his people to pray about it. And thirdly, he fulfills his plan in answer to their prayers. What's he doing? Can he do it without our prayers? Yes. Does he choose to do it without our prayers? No. Why does he use our prayers? So that we get to work with him. So that we get the joy of seeing him act on our behalf and on behalf of others. He's bringing us up, as it were, as being co-workers. We are co-workers with God. He does the choosing. He brings us in. He enables us to share the blessing. This is number four promise. Everyone who asks receives. Those who ask in faith receive. Not just super saints, not just apostles, not just those who are particularly gifted at prayer, but every believer. He who seeks finds. They find now, not just in the future, not just in eternity. They find now, you see? Faith procures the promise. And to those who knock, it shall be opened. In other words, we will never labor in vain when we labor in prayer. Let me underline that. We will never labor in vain when we labor in prayer. Puritan put it, where God finds a praying heart, he will be found to be a prayer-hearing God. Now, I want you to notice how the Lord Jesus brings these inducements to bear upon us in order to get us to pray to our Heavenly Father. In verse 7, he makes a promise. In verse 8, he repeats the promise. In verse 9, he illustrates the promise. In verse 10, he illustrates the promise again, in case you didn't get the first illustration. In verse 11, he emphasizes the promise. You think he's trying to get a point home here? Of course he is. He's trying to convince you of this. Your Heavenly Father cares. No, your Heavenly Father really cares. No, your Heavenly Father really, really cares for you. He really cares for you. Your Heavenly Father, who is the judge, by the way. Your Heavenly Father, who is the king, by the way, in the context of this sermon. Those are his three main points. God as king, God as father, God as judge. The king and the judge, he is your father. He is your father. And he wants you to come to him. He wants you to come to him and pray based on the knowledge that you have of him. That's why we need the Word of God, so that we know the mind of God. You see, we read the Bible, we listen to sermons, we come to worship, and we expose ourselves to the Word of God, not just to learn lessons, not just to have a kind of lecture on some general religious theme, but we come to know the way God thinks about things. His mind. That's what we mean when we say we have the mind of God. We learn the mind of God. Our thinking is renewed as we listen to the Word of God. Over time, our thinking is renewed so that we start thinking the way God thinks, because we're so used to listening to the way He speaks. The more you listen to someone talk, the more you discover the way they think. And we come to God's Word in order that we might know God's will. And we pray based on our knowledge of the will of God. We pray in faith. That's why we humble ourselves before the will of God. That's why we say, not my will, but yours be done. That's why we come to God and we say with Job, the Lord gives, the Lord takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. I'm going to trust God. I'm going to trust God. And prayer presupposes desire, a desire for the will of God to be done. For those who receive Jesus, every one of them who asks, receives. Martin Luther has a lovely word here about Jesus motivating us. This is what he writes, quote, "He knows that we are timid and shy, that we feel unworthy and unfit to present our needs to God. We think that God is so great and we are so tiny that we do not dare pray. That's why Christ wants to lure us away from such timid thoughts, to remove our doubts and to have us go ahead confidently and boldly, ask, seek, knock." And even the illustrations illustrate this. When you wonder, well, sometimes whether prayer is really worth it. Yeah, you are. You've held a dying child in your arms. You've lifted that child up in prayer that God would spare the child, and God has not answered the prayer the way you want it. Your financial world is crashing around your ears. You said, Lord, spare me from this disaster, and God has not answered that prayer the way you wanted it to be done. What do you need to know? You need to know what I need to know. And what Jesus emphasizes here, that when I come to God as one of His children. He is my Heavenly Father. And just like a child goes to their parents when they need something, when they're hungry and they need food, or they're thirsty and they need something to drink, we're to go to our Heavenly Father with the same kind of trust and the same kind of confidence that the Heavenly Father will hear us as a child hears their parents. We come to God as His children. And we come to God expecting good things. You know how realistic Jesus is about humanity. He says, even though you being evil, that is, the best parents are still evil. We're sinners. But even evil parents don't give children a stone instead of a loaf. Most parents look out for their kids. If that's true, that's the lesser thing. The greater thing, our Heavenly Father, will only give good things to those who ask. We shouldn't think that we're either better to ourselves or to our children than our Heavenly Father is to His. In fact, our fatherhood and motherhood is only a vague shadow and reflection of God's heavenly fatherliness. God is a better Father than we could ever be. And Jesus is saying, trust Him. If you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, there's the argument, from the lesser to the greater, how much more will your Father in heaven give what is good to those who ask Him? And what about those prayers? Those prayers for which the answer is no. Can I put this gently? That when God says no to you, it may in fact, from an eternal perspective, when you get home to glory, be the kindest answer and the best answer that you ever hear. That's what believers have experienced over and over again in their lives. There are certain prayers which seem to be resolutely answered no And in the scheme of things, they've been able to look back and to say, thank you, God. The ancient Greeks used to have a saying, whom the gods would destroy, they answer their prayers. Calvin says this. He reminds us that God does not hear our prayers and answer them as we ask them, but he answers them as we would ask them if we were wiser. You hear that? He answers them as we would ask them if we were wiser. Or Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, thank God he has not answered all my prayers with a yes, but he has given me what I needed even when I didn't know it was what I needed. Now that takes faith, doesn't it, to believe that? That takes faith. You say that's a tall order, Liam. But aren't we meant to walk by faith and not by sight? Isn't this meant to be a life of faith? Aren't we meant to believe God? Isn't that what this is all about? If I see it, then I'm not walking by faith. I'm walking by sight. On this side of the celestial city, I walk by faith. And when eventually I'm standing in his presence, what's he going to do? He's going to wipe away every tear, the cause of it, and the pain of it. Wipe away every tear. Now says the Lord Jesus, in the language of one of our old hymns, thou art coming to a king. Large petitions with thee bring, for his grace and power are such, none can ever ask too much. Well, it's in the light of that, then, that Jesus goes on in verse 12 to say the golden rule. That's what we call the golden rule. And he says, this is ultimately the application of the judge not that he said earlier. This is a practical application. Once you've been talking to your Heavenly Father, once you've recognized that you have nothing to bargain with or to plead on your own merit, once you realize that you're utterly dependent on God for daily grace, it punctures your pride. You're no longer someone who has got to be thought well of. You're no longer focused on making an impression or having a reputation. The person in that position is then able to do what Jesus says in verse 12. Whatever you wish that others would do to you, you do to them. You notice it's in the positive, not in the negative. Kant and Confucius and Hillel, the rabbi, all had the negative form of this: don't do to others what you don't want them to do to you. That's very easy. It's not demanding. That doesn't mean you have to do anything. You're just kind of passive. Jesus makes it demanding. It's far more searching. There are no limits to this. Whatever you wish others would do to you, you do to them. Summarizes all the law and all the prophets. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that in this business and this matter of prayer, subject that very often provokes more guilt and angst than joy in our hearts, is nonetheless the means by which we come to you. Here in this position of prayer, there's no one else to impress. There's nothing we can give to you in prayer or in our lives of obedience that add anything to the luster of your name. No, it's here in prayer that we realize that anything we have comes from you. And we want to praise your glory. And pray that today we would learn how to pray with greater diligence and with strong persistence for your cause and kingdom in the world. We ask it in Jesus' name. invite all those who know and love the Lord Jesus, who've been baptized and are members of a Bible-believing church to join us as we gather around the Lord's table this morning. This table is, of course, not only a celebration that we share together, it's not only a fellowship meal, though it is that. It's the event which it is the gift that God has given to his church to remind us both of our Savior's first coming and of his second coming. We sit at this table caught between these two great Advents, first Advent, second Advent. First Advent, he came to bear sin. Second Advent, he comes to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. Here we are in the meantime, caught up between the times. It's a good time of year to remember that we are between the times. We're looking forward. We're looking forward as well as looking back. We're remembering what our salvation cost, and we're looking forward to all that our salvation won in our coming Savior. And that's how we come to this table this morning, thinking of our Savior as he took bread that night he was betrayed, and as he took it, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you."
Isaiah 49. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exalt, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, unto singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted. But Zion said, "The Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me." Can a woman forget her nursing child, that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. Behold, I have engraven you on the palms of my hands.
The bread of heaven is life for the world. Let's eat together with thanksgiving. After supper, our Lord took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for many for the forgiveness of sins."
Psalm 103. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to the iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him.
Thank you.
The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let's drink with thanksgiving. And through these signs, we proclaim the mystery of our religion. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Thanks be to God. We're going to remain seated to sing 193 in our hymn books. We'll stand for the last stanza. While we're sitting, we're going to receive our offering. Our deacons and deaconesses are actively at work in people's lives, helping those in need. And so the deacon's fund is for that end, and we'll receive the deacon's offering as we sing. From God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.